Sir, we can start the session, sir.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. At the outset, I'd like to thank Dr. Kotturesh, Dr. Kishore, Dr. Prashant, Dr. Dinakar, and Dr. Bidri, the office bearers of NNF, and rest of the office bearers of NNF Karnataka chapter, for really exploring this e-learning. Friends, with the feeling in the heart, I'd like to share. Probably this is likely to be the standard of teaching and learning in the next couple of years with the COVID crisis across the globe. I think it's a wonderful thinking process by the NNF Karnataka State Chapter. Dr. Prashant called me just a week before that I should be talking in one of these classes. I said I love to talk on the art of newborn examination rather than any of the critically ill newborn topics. Friends, before I start, I take this opportunity and pay respect to I dedicate this presentation to my beloved teachers, Professor O.N. Bhaku, Dr. Anil Narang, and Dr. Praveen Kumar from PGH Chandigarh, who started the whole newborn training program in the country, the newborn services. It has a long story to tell. I think what we are today, it is because of such great teachers. And also to my beloved mother, late Dr. Nirmala Kesari. Most of you don't know that she was the founder president of NNF Karnataka State Chapter. With remembrance to these great people who have sacrificed for the well-being of the newborn, let me start. I've been asked to talk on art of the newborn examination. Next slide. Yeah. Let me see. Next slide. Yeah. Friends, before I take you through, let me make what I'm supposed to talk today is, you know that when you are called to labor room to attend a just born baby, the whole purpose of your clinical assessment of the newborn is very different. You go mentally prepared exactly to see that the baby is made pink, breathing spontaneously, and has got sustained spontaneous efforts with the heart rate 100 plus. That's the whole purpose of your newborn assessment in the delivery room. That itself is a structured program called Neonatal Resuscitation Program, Advanced NRP. I know that most of the participants have been certified, and most of you, a good number of you, are facilitators and teachers training this program across the country. So once the baby shifted from mother to the from the labor room to the mother's side, remember immediately after the transition, the baby is put on the mother's chest and abdomen, and breastfeeding is initiated in the labor room itself. That is the current recommendation. The cord is clamped, and you are not interested to do any detailed examination of the newborn at that point of time, neither it is necessary. Subsequently, once the baby and the mother settles in the labor delivery room, they are shifted to postnatal ward or the postoperative ward, wherever they are supposed to be. You are going to see these newborns the same evening or the next morning. That's where you are expected to do a detailed examination of the normal newborn. That's the whole aim of my today's talk will be addressing that. I'm not going to talk on any critical ill newborn aspects. And remember, more than 90% of the newborns fall in this category. Only a small percentage of the babies are shifted to NICU for one or the other problem. Unfortunately, what is happening in our clinical practice, we don't really assess these newborns very meticulously in the postnatal wards or next mother, and we miss a lot of things. And clinical neonatology has another element, like gestational age assessment, that is behind the purview of today's discussion, and neurological examination of the newborn, that itself is a topic. If the baby is admitted with asphyxia, suspected CNS infection, acute encephalopathy, be anything, the examination routinely done is not enough to assess these infants. So neurological examination of the newborn is itself a topic. And what we discuss in our day-to-day rounds in the NICU is problem-oriented clinical approach. If you have a baby with respiratory distress, the approach is very different. A baby is admitted with hyperbilirubinemia, your approach is different. Acute encephalopathy is different. Baby who is admitted with acidosis is different. So I'm not going to talk anything about that. I request Dinakar and Prashant to take up the other topics like gestational age assessment and neurological examination of the neurological examination of the newborn in the course of this period. So, like for any other adult age group, it is no different in the newborn also that we have to take a very meticulous maternal history, the family history, maternal, paternal, pregnancy and perinatal history should be greatly reviewed. When the mother is admitted in the antenatal wards itself for delivery, even before the labor sets in, it is very important that the residents or the consultants take a good information about the maternal history, which includes the age of the mother. You remember, if the mother is too young or if the mother is too aged, beyond 35 years, there are great risks of pregnancy and their outcome. And you need to document or record the blood group of the mother. It is important that if the mother is Rh negative or O positive for that matter, that blood group is very clearly registered in the case sheet so that the pediatric resident or the pediatrician take a note of it. It is important that you take a note on the medical problems that the mother is faced with, like pregnancy-induced hypertension or any other diseases like diabetes, rheumatic heart disease. You know that each of these diseases can influence pregnancy, so also the newborn health, both in terms of morbidity and mortality. And it is important that you know the HIV status of the mother so that all precautions can be taken at the time of delivery. And exposure to recent infections and exposure probably relevant in the current epidemic of pandemic of coronavirus, the history of traveling is also equally important. Next. So items which are of particular relevance, as I said earlier, is maternal age, occupational, social background. Our own experience for the last 30 years is with affluence, a lot of mothers are becoming apprehensive. They are faced with a lot of issues when the baby is born and shifted next to them, despite they being highly qualified, unlike our rural mothers. So you are mentally prepared what is the background of the family when you are going for examination. It is important that you have a detailed previous pregnancy history and the problems that are faced by those children. You see that so many diseases can be inherited, can recur in subsequent siblings. Right now we have a baby 4 days old who is admitted with a dehydration, dyselectrolytemia and hyperbilirubinemia. The whole family is panicked because 8 years back this baby's sibling was admitted in the unit and we had made a diagnosis of urea cycle disorder. So the parents are very anxious so that this baby also has a similar problem and we are awaiting TMS. So it is important that previous health records are available of the sibling, history of maternal disease and drug intake. It's very important. A lot of mothers are on drugs for long-term diseases like hypertension, diabetes, rheumatic prophylaxis, and anticoagulants and anti-epileptics. Good number of mothers are epileptics. So all that history should be noted down before you examine the infant. So results of previous screening tests, you see a lot of anxious couple come to you with antenatal blood tests, ultrasound reports, mild pelvic ectasia. There is mild dilatation of the lateral ventricle on the cranial ultrasound done antenatal anomaly scan. So much of anxiety for the parents. Pregnancy is so anxious moment for the whole family. They'll start communicating to you just even before the baby is born. They share with you the reports of amniocentesis and coronary sampling. So we should be prepared what I should examine after the baby is born. And take a detailed history of the delivery notes. Was it a normal delivery or a cesarean birth or an instrumental delivery? That give you an idea what especially I should be looking in the course of my examination of the newborn. And what is the condition of the baby at the time of birth, whether it needed any types of help in the time, positive pressure ventilation or any aggressive resuscitation. And it is important to note the birth weight of the infant. Friends, because a lot of residents are here, birth weight is the first recorded weight immediately after the delivery. That is a very simple definition. Unfortunately, even today, our babies are born in the community and their weight is recorded only the next morning. So for convenience, birth weight is defined as the first best recorded weight of the newborn anytime within 24 hours after birth. It need not necessarily be immediately after birth because a lot of our newborns in the community, the weight is recorded after 16 hours, 18 hours. So it's all right. If the baby were to be 2.8 at the time of birth and 2.6 the next morning, 2.6 will be recorded because that is the first official record of the weight. And you know that the birth weight, it is the best single most indicator of an individual, which speaks of the future trajectory of life. If all of us are born with more than 2.5 kgs of birth weight, we are really gifted people in the world. The gestational age, and if there is any uncertainty about it, that also should be made very clear. And infant's gender, especially if there are any history of antenatally done or previous sibling, especially when you are faced with disorders of sexual development, that itself is a section. So you should be very careful like taking the records of all this history. So about some mothers do take chronic medications. The influence of that can be there on the newborn, especially antihypertensives, anti-diabetic agents, and mothers can be consuming all drugs during pregnancy, though a little uncommon. It is being documented in different parts of the country because these drugs can have withdrawal symptoms in the newborn. If chronic drug intoxication is there during pregnancy, it can even lead to growth restriction. Avoid about alcohol. It is being consumed by almost all sectors in the community across the country, like rest of the world. So inadvertent consumption of alcohol can lead on to fetal alcohol syndrome and withdrawal syndrome immediately after the birth. Chronic tobacco consumption can lead to placental insufficiency and growth restriction. So with respect to the current pregnancy, even before the baby is born, try to take a word of a probable gestational age, the date of quickening, as I said, fetal testing. If you know that mother had hydramnios, you are mentally prepared. It can be because of multiple gestation if it is there, or either due to from our side as neonatologist, gastrointestinal malformations and open neural tube defects and congenital muscular dystrophies and myopathies. These are the conditions which can be associated with polyhydramnios. With respect to gastrointestinal malformations, proximal is the obstruction, earlier is the onset of hydramnios, severe is the hydramnios, distal is the obstruction, later is the onset of hydramnios, milder is the hydramnios. Fetal urine contributes for majority of the liquor volume. So if there are any fetal diseases, especially agenesis of a kidney, that can be associated with oligohydramnios, and in turn, there can be pressure effects on the growing fetus, and these babies are born growth restricted and can have sudden fetal demise. Infections during pregnancy and any surgical intervention should be registered, and make a note that even the government of India has made administration of glucocorticoids a universal phenomenon. And fortunately, all of our obstetricians are administering. So ensure that this drug has been given and that is recorded in the history, whether mother was suspected or otherwise given any antibiotics and any tocolytic agents that she has received. All this history, like for any other examination, you have to take a note before you start examining the infant. And during the process of birth, what was the mode of presentation? You know that babies who are born by vortex have no major issues, whereas babies which are born by abnormal presentation, especially by a breech, all that stands in great risk of having problems of asphyxia and developmental dysplasia of the hip for that matter. History of rupture of membranes, fever in the mother, and fetal monitoring details should be recorded, whether the meconium amniotic fluid was blood-stained, meconium and volume of liquor is very important. Of course, though we don't tell much about it in the NRP also, it should be recorded because it has its own clinical implication in our clinical practice, as 1 and 5 minute of course score will speak to us about the need for resuscitation and probable long-term neurological outcome in these infants. And any information that you have regarding the placental examination in teaching hospital should be recorded before we start examining the newborn. And this is what exactly being shown. Maternal and family history, relevant obstetrical history, and neonatal history. I think I've taken enough time about taking a good neonatal history before you start examining. Friends, before you start examining, a clinician should be very well versed with some of the common problems that we may need to pick up in the course of examination. Just I have taken a table from a standard book, Fanaroff, prevalence of serious congenital anomalies that are there per 1,000 livers. Look at that. Congenital heart disease, about 6 to 8 per 1,000. Developmental dysplasia of the hip, about 0.8 per 1,000. Talipes equinovarus, about 1.5. Trisomy 21, that is 1.5, about 1 in 650 to 700. cleft lip and cleft palate about 0.8, urogenital anomalies about 1.2, and spina bifida and anencephaly neural tube defects to the tune of 0.5%. So if you have some idea what is the prevalence and incidence of these diseases, you are mentally prepared what I should look for in the course of my examination. Friend, so having shifted the baby from the labor to the mother's abdomen and initiated breastfeeding immediately, and you go to the postnatal ward, I request, because there are a lot of participants in this. Friends, it's my very humble request. Those who are making routine rounds, those who go to NICU and critical areas and wherein you are handling sick infants, you please finish your rounds in the postnatal wards and private wards before you get into the ICU. You never do the other way, that you see babies in the intensive care unit and then go for postnatal rounds and carry all microbes on your hands. And when we talk about so much about hand washing and aseptic precautions, that's a word of advice that I have learned from my teachers. Detect objectives of routine examination that I'm going to discuss is to detect congenital abnormalities which are not already identifiable at birth. No congenital heart disease presents with any problem in the delivery room, most of them. Occasionally do present for asphyxia. Otherwise, even lethal congenital heart disease, they start presenting only after third or fourth day when the ductus starts closing. So it is important, and even congenital diaphragmatic hernia can be missed often if it is not a very massive diaphragmatic hernia. Developmental dysplasia of the hip, something which goes unnoticed unless you examine, you miss that. And determine if any wide range of non-acute neonatal problems are present and initiate their management or reassure their parents. That should be another important objective of your examination. Check for potential problems arising from maternal disease, familial disorders, or problems detected during pregnancy. So just now I shared in the beginning one case scenario. It is so difficult to speak to that mother and the family. Is it the same problem that this baby has? That baby also started deteriorating on fourth day, fifth day, despite we reassuring. So we have to be spending. We should very patiently hear to the presentations made by the mother especially and the rest of the family members and answer their doubts. Providing an opportunity for parents to discuss any questions about their infant. Very, very important. Often we try to make a very fast rounds in the postnatal wards. That is unfair. We have to spend some time with the parents to answer their question. And initiate health promotion for the newborn from the very postnatal ward, be breastfeeding or initiation of immunization or micronutrient supplementation like vitamin D before discharge. Friends, I just shared three pictures here just before I proceed to prevent the monotony. You can see that in the first picture, there is a preauricular sinus. On the other side, there is a necessary tragus. Both these are first and second bronchial arch abnormalities of closure and faltering fusion. In the sinus, then it doesn't look anything great. But hygiene is not maintained, this preauricular sinus may get frequently infected, and these infants are brought for pain, fever, and discharge from the sinus. There is no urgency to take a ENT reference for that. If there is any issue like that, you can take the opinion and intervene electively at a later date or in the later half of infancy. However, accessory tragus that you can see in the right side of the picture, this is again a first and second bronchial arch defect. But remember, these can give clue to underlying genitourinary tract anomalies. Often they are seen in isolation. However, they can be associated with the golden arch syndrome, Treacher-Collins syndrome, or some of the vectoral association syndromes. So these should be taken as a clue. Should I really look for ultrasound abdomen and pick up any renal anomalies? In the picture below, you are seeing nipple. You can see there is a darkened area in line with the nipple. Usually these accessory nipples are seen in line with the imaginary line drawn between the mid-axillary line and the mid-inguinal line anywhere along. This is called as the mammary line. And these are of no clinical significance. It can be areola with a nipple. Especially if it is a girl child, parents become so anxious that the baby has a third breast tissue. You have to convince and make it very clear to the parents. This has no tendency of developing into a breast even later in life. If they are very anxious, you can remove it for a cosmetic reason at a later date. So these needs a lot of reassurance. A lot of questions run through such small things that are there in the infant. Next. The first overall visual and auditory appraisal of the naked infant is most informative. To examine the newborn, few things, golden principles are very important. Preferably at that point of time when you are unclothing the infant, see that the air conditioning is off, the fan is not kept very fast, the baby is unclothed, and preferably you try to examine the mother in the presence of parents. Never examine, take the baby elsewhere and do examination. The parents will be anxiously observing how the doctor is assessing my baby. And take all aseptic precautions, maybe a chemical scrub or a hand wash before any newborn is examined. Remember, all newborns are universally sterile at birth, and they got colonized with staph aureus. By 3 to 4 days, the whole body is colonized with staph aureus. So it is very important we don't transmit any infection during their hospital stay. Same part of clinical assessment, some part of the clinical assessment of the newborn is worthless. We don't practice a systematic examination that you do in an old child or an adult for that matter. And remember, with experience, if one good examination of the newborn, normal examination of the newborn, should not take more than 5 to 7 minutes. And that examination is very important. To name or to label a baby as normal is more skillful event rather than telling that the baby has respiratory distress and alveolar membrane disease. I need to administer surfactants and start on CPAP, because this is a very responsible and iterative examination. Next slide. So initial examination of the newborn is aimed at whether any congenital anomalies that are present, I'll take up later, but it is very important from head to toe, you carefully look for any visible swellings on the head like occipital encephalocele, a neurotube defect on the back, and try to do just so. Even before you examine the baby, a lot of information can be gathered. You try to make most of the observation by inspection. You need very little palpation to take a note, and you keep those interventions which cause pain to the infant at the end of the examination, like looking for hip examination. So most of the examination findings can be picked up on general physical examination of the newborn. It is very important that the infant has made good transition from the mother's womb to air breathing. You should confirm that there is good adaptation that has taken place. So many times the babies are shifted on second and third day because of wrong judgment and lack of observation with respiratory distress, and you know that these babies have developed transient tachypnea of the newborn and sometimes even hyaline membrane disease. So these infants need to be confirmed that they have settled to baseline respiration, color, breathing, and saturation, and those things I mean. To what extent gestation, labor, delivery, analgesics have affected the newborn, that also should be registered, especially infants that are born to mothers who received a lot of drugs due to cesarean or for any other medical disorders. These babies may be very sleepy, excessively sleepy, may have some sleeping, feeding issues. So parents will be anxious to clarify that. Whether he or she has any signs of infection or metabolic disease, which was unsuspected. So whenever you are doubtful, accordingly, you should plan proceeding. Next. As I said, please examine the newborn unclothed. Even today, I see residents examining the baby with caps on, sweaters on, with huggies. I don't know what examination we do. I'm very sorry to say this. So at least one good examination prior to discharge should be done with totally naked newborn. And as far as the time to, when should I time the examination? This examination, which needs very important for the family, for the newborn, and for the fraternity, is when the baby gets up for a feed. Never examine a baby which is deeply sleeping, because you are gone for a detailed examination. It's all right for a routine rounds. But to do one good examination, it is always better you examine the baby who is just awake. That happens to be just before the scheduled feed, or just immediately after the feed, and you handle the baby with utmost gentle. Remember, in the newborn who is there in the postnatal ward, you see a spectrum, milieu of cutaneous manifestations. I'm going to share pictures of this. Erythematoxicum, milia, neonatal pustular melanosis, Epstein pearls, and Mongolian spots. And you have to make a note of that. Sometimes parents are very anxious for these lesions. You have to explain to them, though they are so benign, parents will be waiting for your answers. visualizing opening at either end. All of you remember our teachers have told and taught, check for three orifices, the nose and the mouth above, and rule out cleft lip, cleft palate, choanal atresia, and ensure the patency of the anus below. I think that's a wise statement. Even today, we continue to see ARM, anorectal malformation, referred on third day, fourth day, with history that baby has not passed ulcers and developed abdominal distension. If you have missed imperforate anus in the postnatal ward, you have missed a golden opportunity. Watch out for jaundice. You know how physiological jaundice presents. By chance, if any baby develops jaundice within first day, it is always pathological, and unless proved otherwise. And the most common cause of jaundice on day one will be hemolytic jaundice. Probably apohemolytic disease is emerging as an important cause, since Rh hemolytic disease has been conquered to a major grade. Next slide. Yeah, this is given in any standard book. I am not going to take much time. I'm going to take individual organ for that matter. So you have to record the weight of the baby. I said, what is the birth weight? The length of the infant and the heart surface using infantometer or neonatometer. The weight of the newborn on an average is about 2.5 to 3.8 or 4 kgs in Indian scenario. And the length of the baby is anywhere from 48 to 55 centimeters in term gestation. Then you try to see the head and the face, try to feel the fontanelle. I'm just sharing pictures later. I'm just giving an overview. And facial appearance. In the eyes, you have to do detailed examination of normal and abnormal. In the mouth, you look for cleft lip, cleft palate, any additional digits in the upper extremities, respiratory rate, chest retractions, heart sounds and murmurs. Feel for pulse, one in the upper limb and one in the lower limb. Then in the lower limbs, try to look for congenital talipes, equinovarus, any defects on the back of the spine and external genitalia, and looking for hip dislocation, developmental dysplasia of the hip at the end of the examination. Friends, these are very common cutaneous manifestations. The first picture shows milia. They are retention cysts that are seen very commonly in the newborn over the cheek, over the forehead, over the chin. Very normal in the later part of the first week of life. Nothing to worry. All that you need to is you reassure the mother. Miliaria, these are nothing but prickly heat. You can see them over the skull, over the face, over the neck, over the trunk, over the extremities. And in the picture on the right side, you see miliaria rubra. That is very classical prickly. Now that the summer is coming, very frequently you are going to see these types of skin lesions. And anxious mother brings these infants that the rash is spreading fast to the rest of the body. They ask whether it is some exanthematous fever. For that matter, now that they are reading on the net, there are cutaneous manifestation of corona. You may not be surprised that these lesions are related to corona infections. So these are all very normal findings that are seen in the newborn. Next slide. Erythema toxicum. This is something very commonly seen in our day-to-day practice with a frequency of nearly 5 to 70%. In Asiatic population, it is seen up to 50 to 70%. It is nothing but the hypersensitive response of the newborn skin for Wernicke caseosa. These are looking papillomacular. You can see that there are erythematous lesions with vesicular eruptions in the center. These lesions start appearing after third or fourth day, continuing to increase in the rest of the first week and the second week, and most of the time they disappear by second week. If you make any smears out of this, you can demonstrate eosinophilic infiltrates, demonstrating that this is an allergic response. This doesn't warrant any local application or systemic medications. Parents need to be reassured that nothing will happen. It will settle with time. You use just skin-friendly clothing and keep the baby just warm enough. Next slide. And avoid the skin irritants like powder and other cosmetic creams. You often see in the newborn pustular eruptions, sometimes very scary, multiple over the head, forehead, extremities, over the trunk and the chest. You can see them peeling off. These are very normal. The general tendency for the residents and the family members first means infection. They get really scared. What infection is this? Friends, there is an entity called neonatal pustular melanosis. These are sterile pustules. They appear like erythema toxicum in the later part of the first week, and they burst and leave healing a scar by the end of second week of life. Most of them heal, leaving without any scar in long term. And this doesn't warrant any cutaneous antibiotic cream or any systemic antibiotic medications. It is said only if they are large, multiple, close to joints, or close to a superficial bone with evidence of underlying skin inflamed or infected, then only you should consider antibiotics. Otherwise, there is no role. Whatever I am discussing, you need to reassure parents rather than practicing medications for this. Next slide. Neonatal acne, you can see this is very common, usually seen between 2 to 4 weeks of the newborn due to the hormonal effects that are seen in the peripartum period. Similarly, you see in the babies benign breast engorgement and bleeding per vagina and white discharge per vagina. All these findings are seen in a pubertal aged girl. So we fascinatingly call it as premature puberty of the newborn. To sum up, acne neonatorum, benign breast engorgement, pseudomenses and white discharge per vagina, these are all very benign normal physiological variants, don't warrant any treatment. You ask them to keep the skin utmost clean and dry. Don't apply any creams, though there are studies which have shown that some of these lesions have demonstrated some pathogens. There is role for application of some creams, including steroids. There is no role. None of us have practiced for last 30 years, and we have had no problem treating neonatal acne, but for reassurance in all the time. Though not transient lesion, this is very common, Mongolian spot. This is a bluish gray spot that is seen on the back. It is nothing to do with Mongolian race. It is nothing to do with Down syndrome. Friends, it is very common in Asiatic population, again, seen in about 40 to 60% of the population. Interestingly, this particular lesion is uncommon in Mohammedan population, especially living in Middle East countries. So it is said that those people celebrate the birth of a baby with Mongolian spot. They assume that this baby is kicked by Allah from heaven, is a blessed child, is going to be a genius. There are certain myths about Mongolian spots. These lesions are due to constant rubbing of the back of the newborn against the mother's uterine wall. Number two, it is because of the retained blood that the mother has not menstruated throughout 9 months of pregnancy that has caused the discoloration. Number three, there is misconception, belief that it is due to practicing sex during pregnancy that has caused the discoloration. Friends, none of these things are reality. The truth is, this is due to migrational arrest of the melanocytes. These lesions fade with advancing age. Most of these lesions disappear by the end of the first year. And so many times, mothers, parents become so panicked. Dark lesion, girl child, will it persist for life? There should not be any differential diagnosis for this. However, because a lot of fellows are there in the group, let me tell you, for all you have to offer, you should offer giant kefalate spots and bathing trunk nevus as a differential diagnosis. Remember, both of them look very different than what I have shown here, and nobody should have any confusion. There should not be any differential diagnosis for Mongolian spot. Next slide. Cutis marmorata, reticulated appearance pattern that you see here, very normally seen in healthy newborns in the first month of life. This indicates vasomotor instability. So it is of no clinical significance if otherwise baby is active, maintaining normal temperature and feeding well. So you need to reassure parents. However, persistence of this beyond 1 month should warrant you. Probably there are clues that the baby has got features of trisomy 21 or 18, or baby has other syndromic features, or any other inherited disorders. However, throughout first year, month of life, cutis marmorata is a normal finding. So capillary hemangiomas on the nape of the neck and in front, over the forehead, over the upper eyelid is very, very normal. You need to reassure parents. They disappear with port vein stain. These lesions disappear with advancing postnatal age. Unless they are tufted hemangiomas, so-called Cassavetes-Merritt syndrome, there is no role to administer any steroids or any local application to treat these infants. So these are very normal, and you need to reassure parents. So whatever dermatological conditions just now I shared with you need to be just reassured to the parents. Friends, with that, let us see what are the normal findings. The head circumference in the newborn approximately is about 33 to 36 centimeters. You should record with a good measuring tape. A good pediatric resident is one who carries a measuring tape a functioning torch, any hammer, along with your stethoscope. Never come to wards without these ornaments for clinical practice. And you should know how to differentiate between caput succedaneum and cephalhematoma. Minor molding of the skull bones is normal. Craniotabes is very common in post-mature babies. You should feel for the fontanelle on the head. Usually they are two, anterior and posterior. In the newborn, you do appreciate two anterior lateral and two posterior lateral fontanelle also. Total about six of them. Check neck for range of motion. Any swellings in the neck, any hard swelling in the midline, you should suspect neonatal goiter. Any soft cystic swelling in the neck, you should consider cystic hygroma. Make the baby open the mouth by gentle rocking and see anybody can pick up cleft lip and anterior cleft palate. If you miss posterior cleft palate, which may happen with period ovens or in isolation, if you miss cleft palate in the neonatal period, you have missed a golden opportunity. So many times, infants are admitted with failure to thrive, aspiration pneumonia, 3 months, 4 months. On examination, you notice that the baby has a posterior cleft palate. Extant pearls are pearly lesions that are seen along the midline in the fusion line of the palate. These are very normal retention cysts, very normal phenomenon. When the baby is crying, mother notices this and becomes very anxious. You need to reassure the mother. Similar lesions can be seen on the tip of the penis. In boys, they need reassurance. This is a very classical teaching. The stratum of swelling when it comes to caput, subgaleal hemorrhage and cephalhematoma. Caput is the most common swelling of the scalp that is seen in our day-to-day practice, which is a diffuse swelling over the presenting part. Cephalhematoma refers to the subperiosteal bleed that is shown on the right side. It is a collection of blood. It is starts appearing postnatally, increases in size. It can be single or multiple. It can be asymmetrical or different in sizes. Important risk is that may develop blood loss anemia or hyperbilirubinemia, warranting phototherapy. The most dangerous thing is subgaleal hemorrhage. The layers of the scalp are remembered as skin, cutaneous tissue, aponeurotica galea, loose areolar tissue, and pericranium. If the stratum of bleeding is subgaleal aponeurosis, then it is called a subgaleal hemorrhage. Friends, this is relatively a large anatomical site. The amount of bleed into this space can almost equal to the blood volume of the newborn. You should be very careful monitoring these infants. If you see a diffuse swelling of the skull, especially following instrumental delivery or asphyxiated infant, you should carefully look for subgaleal hemorrhage. 20% of these subgaleal hemorrhages are associated with mortality. So if they're asphyxiated, all that, you shift them to NICU. Otherwise, these babies are shifted to postnatal wards, and you need to recognize them in your daily rounds. Next slide. Friends, I guess some of the ophthalmologists are also attending this. A word about examination of the newborn. Newborns have physiological photophobia. Remember, as a fetus, it has never seen light for 9 months. The moment baby is born, it is seeing bright atmosphere in the labor room. Subsequently, in the postnatal wards in the NICU, baby is forced with so much of noxious visual and auditory stimulation for which baby is not used to. You should remember this is a normal phenomenon. No baby wish to open their eyes immediately after birth. It takes an average 1 month for the infant to comfortably open the eyes. Never try to open the eyes manually in the newborn. To make the baby open its eyes, you should try to take the baby to relatively a darker part of the room. Gently rock the baby from 30 to 45 degrees angle for a few minutes. See, it is a pleasure watching the baby open its eyes. What you are supposed to see in the eyes, normally some degree of lid edema is normal in the newborn. Once the baby opens its eyes, subconjunctival hemorrhages are seen very often, especially in asphyxiated babies, cord around the neck, face presentations. And you can see squint and strabismus very normally in the newborn. And if you are competent and your ophthalmology colleagues have a look at the fundoscope, you can even demonstrate retinal hemorrhages similarly, like in asphyxiated babies and bruised babies. All these are normal findings. Lid edema, physiological photophobia, subconjunctival hemorrhage, squint, strabismus, and retinal hemorrhages. The vision of the newborn is hypermyopic, friends. It is about 20 to 20 by 400 is the vision of the newborn. The revision normal 20 by 20 is reached only by 2 to 3 years of age. So most important clinical examination for us is try to look for red reflex. You try to, before discharging, blow a light on the eyes of the newborn and appreciate red reflex. Instead, you see a white reflex, you should be very careful. That can be the earliest clue that you are faced with retinoblastoma. So in the eye examination, you should be very gentler. And often parents come with history that there is little matting of eyelashes. Baby is not opening eyes. I keep telling, neonatal ophthalmia is a overdiagnosed entity in clinical practice. None of us have time to really advise and counsel parents. We see parents bringing variety of drops in their cover. D-tobramycin, V-ofloxacillin, V-gentamicin. Friends, there is no need for any of these drops in clinical practice. Ophthalmia neonatorum has almost become a rare clinic superficial ophthalmic diagnosis in our clinical practice. Avoid using drops unless it is indicated. As I said, nystagmus, squint are very normal. Next slide. That's about the eye examination in the newborn. Friends, we don't do a systematic cardiovascular system examination as far as newborn is concerned. I keep telling you. Color is probably the single most important index of cardiac status. If baby is pink, what else you want? You can be certain this baby's heart is functioning normally. This baby's ventilation is going fine. The tissue perfusion is fine. You need to just doubly confirm by a couple of other vital parameters. Newborns breathe at a rate of 40 to 60 per minute, and most infants may have periodic breathing rather than regular breathing. Periodic means they breathe fast for a short period. They will pause for a few seconds, about 10 to 15 seconds, and again they start breathing fast. It's a normal phenomenon. Unless there is cessation of breathing for more than 20 seconds, you don't make a diagnosis of apnea in otherwise healthy infants. Be familiar with sequential changes during cardiorespiratory, cardiopulmonary adaptation. The heart rate in the newborn is 100 to 160, to be more specific, 120 to 160. Anything more than 160 is tachycardia, and less than 100 is bradycardia and is of concern. You should always make it a point to feel. We are used to feel one of the pulse in our clinical practice. You feel one of the upper limb pulse and one of the lower limb pulse. If you miss, like you said, posterior cleft palate, if you miss coarctation of aorta in the newborn period, you have missed coarctation of aorta given a golden opportunity. Some of them may be ductal dependent lesions. And I also like to mention that there can be mild variation in the volume of the pulses in the upper and lower limbs for the initial 3 days. You need not worry about it. As long as you feel both the upper and lower limb pulses, don't worry. This examination is very important prior to discharge. If at all you have to auscultate anything over the precordium of the healthy newborn, don't bother about auscultating the apex. Second space, you try to appreciate the split second heart sound, A2, P2. It is single in fetal life. It starts splitting and widening postnatally. The physiological splitting of the first heart sound is appreciated by expert by in 50% of the time by 24 hours, in about 75% by about 48 hours, in about 90% of babies by 72 hours. I keep telling, if you are unable to appreciate the split second heart sound behind 72 hours, that is prior to discharge, be careful. You may be faced with an underlying serious structural heart disease. That can be the only clue for an underlying lethal congenital heart disease. We are not interested in murmurs or anything else in the heart. We are not interested in percussing for the heart powders, not going aortic area, pulmonary area, anything. Please try to auscultate for the second heart sound. Murmurs means very less in the newborn than at any other time. It is said 12 out of 13 murmurs in the newborn are functional. You try to discuss this finding with the parents and try to evaluate it if the murmurs are presented when they are coming for follow-up. No need to do a routine echocardiogram just because you hear a murmur in the postnatal ward. I said 12 out of those 13 echocardiographs are unwarranted. Next slide. So this is what I said. There is a nice way of picking up a congenital heart disease in the newborn NADAS criteria. Unless there is a systolic murmur with a thrill, unless baby presents for features of congestive heart failure, there is a diastolic murmur. Short of that, these are called as NADAS major criteria. Otherwise, long systolic murmur, abnormal second sound, cardiomegaly, abnormal ECG pattern, these are all minor NADAS criteria. Two major or one major and two minor NADAS criteria should make an alert. Congenital heart disease in the newborn don't present the way it presents in older child. It presents for syndromic presentation. You suspect congenital heart disease in the newborn when an infant presents for shock, when an infant presents for congestive heart failure, when an infant presents for any abnormal heart rhythms, arrhythmias, and when the infant is present for unexplained central cyanosis. These are called syndromic presentation of congenital heart disease in the newborn. We never make a diagnosis of heart disease based on the murmurs of the newborn. Next slide. As far as the abdomen is concerned, you should be very careful. The abdomen of the newborn always looks full in your day-to-day practice. If there is any scaphoid abdomen in the postnatal ward, which sometimes you may miss with antenatal scans or not done or done, you should be careful whenever there is a scaphoid abdomen, whether I am faced with esophageal atresia without tracheoesophageal fistula or a diaphragmatic hernia wherein the coils of intestine have gone into left hemipelvis. Otherwise, the abdomen should be looking full. The baby, the air that swallows immediately after birth takes about 24 hours for it to reach the rectum. So liver is palpable in the newborn up to about 2.5 centimeters. Spleen is rarely palpable, but a few authors do mention tip of the spleen may be palpable in healthy term babies. Not beyond that, there can be small umbilical hernia normally in the newborn. And you should try to feel the abdomen kidney carefully by bimanual pump or very gentler palpation. You can feel the upper pole of one of the kidney in routine abdominal examination. That is not abnormal. Any significantly palpable abdominal lump in the newborn in young infant is renal in origin unless proved otherwise. These are very powerful statements that our teachers have taught us in the course of learning, and that holds good even today. Otherwise, palpable liver, palpable upper pole of the kidney, just palpable spleen should be treated as a normal finding in the newborn. This is something that you see in your day-to-day practice. Whether you advise or not, parents are very fond of putting talcum powder over the umbilical region, or otherwise somebody prescribe neosporin powder. Friends, when the umbilical stump is umbilical cord is clamped, that is the only surgical wound that is the baby is born with. We should be very careful. That should not be the portal of entry for the organisms. There is no need to apply anything to the umbilical stump in the postnatal ward routinely. There is no need to apply any antibiotics. No need to apply any antibiotic powders. Usually the umbilical stump falls on its own by 7 to 10 days. When it falls, little serous discharge from the umbilicus is normal. If you apply talcum powder, anything like that, there is going to be granuloma. This is an iatrogenic problem. If you read any standard books, the recommendation is copper sulfate cauterization or chemical cauterization. At this juncture, I'm very happy to share our beloved teacher, Dr. Kesari, showed that simple application of common salt crystal to this granulomatous tissue will make the granuloma melt. BD application for about 10 minutes to half an hour every day for 3 days. This granulomatous tissue melts like ice, and this has been published in Lancet. I'm not just sharing experience. I take this opportunity, those who are listening across the country, please make it a point. Simple common salt crystal application to this umbilical granuloma is very, very rewarding. Don't apply any antiseptic lotions, antiseptic solutions in your day-to-day practice, be gentian violet, be tincture benzoin or betadine, whatever it is. Don't stain the abdomen, otherwise you'll miss early onset of umbilical sepsis subsequently. Next. So with this, they should rarely once in a while you see umbilical polyp, and then if there is any persistent discharge from the umbilicus, especially foul smelling fluid from the umbilicus, behind the first week, 2 weeks of life, you have to think of urachal cyst, persistent vitelointestinal duct, and those issues. Next slide. In male babies, coming to the genitalia, phimosis is a physiological phenomenon. Both the testes would have descended in about 90% of the babies by term gestation. In nearly 5 to 10% of the babies, one of the testes may be in the process of descent at the time of birth. The absence of one of the testicle in the scrotal sac need not be worrying. You wait for some time before you make a diagnosis. try to carefully feel for the testis somewhere in the inguinal canal or the inguinoscrotal junction. Small hydrocele are physiological. Most of the hydrocele that are present in the newborn results spontaneously. We hardly remembered getting any of the hydrocele separated. They are very benign lesions in the newborn. I keep telling residents, scrotum is a good clue that the baby's temperature is fine. Baby is euthermic. If a male baby has got a pendulous sagging scrotal sac with testicles inside, in all probability it says baby is euthermic, its cardiovascular and pulmonary system are absolutely functioning. Length and width of the penis should be noted. If you are doubtful, please record the length of the penis. Stretched phallic length should be normally more than 2.5 centimeters. If it is less than, then only you call it as micropenis and start working for it. Friends, in female babies, at term gestation, the labia majora will be relatively enlarged. As I shared early, you should look for vaginal orifice and the urethral orifice. Occasional mucus tacts are normal. Pseudomenses and white discharge. I see second day when you go to postnatal ward, mother, what is the problem? Baby is bleeding. Just check that baby has received vitamin K. If it has missed it, doubly ensure that vitamin K is given. If necessary, repeat a dose of vitamin K, nothing more than that. Ask parents that you keep the private parts clean and dry. Anus and rectum should be checked for patency, position and size. Sometimes it can be anterior placed ectopic anus. There can be high anorectal malformation. All babies should pass urine by 24 hours. All babies should pass meconium by 48 hours. Behind this time, you should start worrying for investigating for oliguria or anuria or any gastrointestinal malformation or high anorectal malformation or other conditions. Next slide. Friends, with that, I'm just coming to the later finishing slides. The anomalies of the digits, club feet, and hip dislocation are common. Mild physiological bowing of tibia is very normal. Until the infant starts standing and bearing weight, bowing of tibia is absolutely physiological. It doesn't warrant any investigations. Before discharging, you should doubly ensure that you do a developmental dysplasia of hip screening. Check for spine. The back should be examined for a dimple, sinus, or a tuft of hair. A spina bifida occulta should be looked for. Next slide. Before I just discuss or share two slides of developmental dysplasia, you should be aware this is something very important. If people miss this finding in the Western world, in any European countries, United States of America, they are penalized very heavily. Look at the incidence of developmental dysplasia of the hip, taking into account 1,000 newborns. Taking all newborns put together, it's about 11.5 per 1,000 newborns. This condition is more commoner in females in a ratio of 1:4 otherwise. If there is positive family history, all the more it becomes more important in terms of ratio. In girls, it is about 32 per 1,000 newborns. In breech-born babies, it is much more frequent. 15 to 30% more frequently developmental dysplasia of the hip is seen in breech-born babies as against vortex presentation. Next slide. So, after doing developmental dysplasia of the hip screening examination, if your physical examination turns out to be positive, which I will be showing in my next slide, please refer to a very knowledgeable orthopedic surgeon. Friends, with feeling in my heart, I am telling, very few dedicated pediatric orthopedics you get available in majority of the cities. So I request you yourself for a pediatric orthopedic surgeon. You should start learning how to really check for developmental dysplasia. When should I get ultrasound of the hip joint? All that. If physical examination is inconclusive, following examination should be done at 2 weeks. If the physical examination is normal, but there are risk factors that the baby is a female, a girl child, there is strong family history, all that. I have mentioned here, I will be sharing my presentation subsequently. I want to take up some questions. So in those cases, you can plan doing an ultrasound of the hip joint. X-ray is not warranted. It is not useful until about 4 months of age. To make a diagnosis of developmental dysplasia of X-ray, in the newborn, X-ray is not warranted. However, in the competent hands, developmental dysplasia of the hip can be picked up by ultrasound of the hip joint. Next slide. This is the test that you have to do. We have been told since you are a UG that there are two tests. The test above is called as Barlow's test. It is a provocative test. What you are doing in the test above is by adducting, you are trying to flexing the hip joint, you are trying to put the head of the femur into the acetabulum and you appreciate a click of entry. So that is called as Barlow's maneuver. And in the test below, the first one is called as provocative test. The opposite of that is called as Ottolani's maneuver. That is an attempt to dislocate the hip. You try to abduct and dislocate the hip from the acetabulum. Unfortunately, I can't show this. This is something that you have to learn bedside on a flat surface, keeping the infant. As I said in the beginning, this test should be kept at the end of the newborn examination, as it do cause some amount of pain and baby may become irritable and parents may not like it. Keep this test at the end of your examination. If there is any developmental dysplasia of the hip, you see that our orthopedic colleagues will put Barlow's harness as shown in the right diagram in the picture. Next slide. So this is not a topic for me. Neurological examination should be done in stage 3 or 4 of partial state of wakefulness. Best examination of the newborn is done when the baby is in stage 3 or stage 4 of partial scale. He's a famous neurologist who has assigned the stages of neuroarousability. State 1 is deep sleep, 2 is light sleep, 3 is just awake, 4 is just awake and breaking gross body movements, 5 is awake and crying. So it is ideal that you do a good examination of the newborn in stage 3 or 4 of wakefulness so that you get a fair idea that the infant is neurologically normal. If the baby is crying fine without any abnormal deviation of the oral cavity, all that, you can ensure all the cranial nerves are fine. Differentiate between normal and pathological cry. With experience, you can make out the infant is crying in the next room, whether it is a physiological cry of hunger or a pathological cry of pain. And you need to elicit minimum tendon and deep tendon reflexes in your day-to-day examination. Let me not go. Be gentler. Your middle finger is more than knee hammer in the postnatal ward to elicit deep tendon reflexes. Before concluding, you should just elicit a couple of reflexes in the postnatal wards, especially fellows and residents who are working. Morose reflex, I need not tell what it is. Plantar and palmar grass, placing and stepping reflex. And as far as lactation is concerned, rooting, sucking and swallowing reflex of the infant, and the milk letdown and milk expression reflex in the mother for successful breastfeeding. Next slide. This is that you are very familiar. Again, this itself is a class. Ballard's chart I am sharing. It has both physical maturity criteria. Next. And the previous one is neuromaturity. And this is the physical maturity. You have to add up the score to assign the gestational age of the baby. It may not be very meticulously done. It itself is a topic. Especially, this is very important for infants who are admitted in NICU for decision making. As a policy statement. Next slide. That itself is a topic and a discussion in the course of this e-seminars. Next slide. Friends, so before I conclude, at discharge, newborn should be examined with following points in mind. See that baby's heart is functioning fine. If there is a murmur, whether it needs any evaluation, whether baby has cyanosis or any features of heart failure. In terms of CNS, speech second sound, which is physiological, is normally appreciated. The activity of the baby infant is fine. Sutures are well felt. All the fontanelles are felt. Their normal contour, there is no tensed fontanella. No significant abdominal lump is felt in the abdomen. Skin prior to discharge, third day, fourth day, little jaundice is very normal. In the absence of risk factors, you need to reassure. But you should really look for the jaundice. I keep telling, the ideal time for postnatal discharge or perinatal discharge is day 4 of life. Friends, from maternal point of view, by 72 hours, you see that the mother has completely recovered from parturition. She had finished her most critical period of parturition. Her lochia would have been healthy. The obstetrician would have felt that there is optimum involution of the uterus. And you see the confidence on the mother's face that she can successfully breastfeed. So only by day 3, never plan a discharge earlier to that. If you discharge them on first and second day, invariably they will come back on third or fourth day. And either there is any need to keep them unnecessarily behind day four or day five if it is a normal delivery. From a pediatrician or neonatal perspectives, it is ideal to discharge the baby by fourth day, because by then infant would have established good latching and would have been successfully breastfeeding. Number two, baby would have presented for any lethal undiagnosed congenital anomalies, as I said, ductal dependent congenital heart disease or diaphragmatic hernia or gastrointestinal malformation for that matter. Number three, baby would have passed urine and stool adequately by then. That's what parents want. In the postnatal wards, what parents are interested, what do you ask in your routine rounds? Has baby passed urine? Has baby passed stools? How the baby is feeding? Did it sleep well? If these four things have happened in time, I think both you are happy, the infant is happy, and the family is happy. Friends, before discharge, ensure that there is no infection of the cord or any evidence of infection of sepsis syndrome. Baby is feeding comfortably, but for throwing small quantity of milk once in a while, there is no abdominal distension. No doubt before discharge, there will be physiological weight loss. If they stay for a longer time, ensure that baby starts gaining weight and the mother has established confidence of breastfeeding. That's what I said. Practice ideal perinatal discharge policy. So at least it takes about 3 days complete for a successful maternal and infant bonding and ideal postnatal or perinatal discharge. Friends, I don't think I will be spending time. If at all, this is what you have to look for. Unless baby is born premature low birth weight, baby is asphyxiated, baby has thrown a fit, baby is recorded to be hypothermic, has distress and recurrent vomiting, develops jaundice on day one. Probably this is what we teach the health worker, health personnel in the community. In the presence of these, you please refer those babies which are born in the community. You should educate the health personnel only in the presence of these danger signs. Please refer them to the nearest unit level, to be a taluk hospital or a district hospital for that matter. With that, I sincerely thank all the office bearers of National Neonatology Forum. I shared the emblem of National Neonatology Forum here. I served the forum for a very long time, and I feel privileged to participate in any of the activities of the NNF. With this, I hand over the mic to Prashant, and I take up any questions from the audience. Thank you everyone for your patient hearing. Dr. Prashant. Dr. Prashant. Hello, I'm audible. No, Prashant. Hello. 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 Nobody is audible. Hello. It is a good appeal.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Even mine was muted. Thank you very much for the lovely presentation and tips and tricks of the normal newborn examination. So there were questions about the umbilical discharge. You had told them that, you know, twice daily for 10 to 15 minutes. They were asking whether it is 10 minutes or 30 minutes. So what you would clearly want to tell the audience, sir?
Umbilical stump. Huh?
Yes, sir. Stump granuloma.
Umbilical granuloma, yeah. Umbilical, you are usually applying copper sulfate. If you look at literature, they recommend chemical cauterization. If it fails, then only electrical cauterization. Please take a common salt crystal that is there in the kitchen, in everybody's house it is there. You tell them not a powder salt, a crystal. Let it be stuck between the granulomatous tissue and the base of the umbilical stump inside. The principle is that when the common crystal, salt crystal, it literally takes a slide of the umbilical granuloma. The tissue melts along with the common salt. You do that application at least for about 10 to 15 minutes daily, twice daily. You need not put any adhesive tape on the top of it. It just gets stuck between the granulomatous tissue and the umbilical stump itself. So do that for 2 days, two times a day, for 3 days. Fourth day, you are seeing a magic. Don't apply anything. After that, you remove the common salt crystal and clean it with sterile water. For that matter, if you are really comfortable, use a sterile Dettol, any antiseptic solution.
Sir, there was some questions on the watering of eyes in a newborn and sticky discharge. So how to decide on when to start the antibiotic eye drops or just with the tear duct massage?
Yeah, usually the watering of eyes, tears are uncommon in the newborn. It takes a few days to first 2 to 3 weeks for the tears to be formed. But I agree with you that routinely when the baby tries to open the eyes, there is a superficial matting of the eyelashes. This is a normal phenomenon. And the nasal lacrimal duct in the infant is relatively vertically placed and narrow and often gets into spasm. So because of that, they are draining from the ear, eyes to the nose is altered in the newborn. Because of that, there is blocking and spillover phenomenon in the eyes. All that you need to do is gentle massage along the lower eyelid from medial to lateral side. Just massage over the medial aspect of the eye, just 5 to 6 times, and then along the lower eyelid, over the eyelid, not over the orbit, the eyeball, over the skin, medial to laterally for a couple of times, preferably when the infant is awake. You need not do it in causing discomfort to the infant, and this problem significantly comes down. Unless there is purulent eye discharge, there is a conjunctival suffusion, or there is lid edema, you should not be treating for ophthalmia neonatorum. It is becoming a rare entity. I keep telling, this is overdiagnosed and overtreated in clinical practice. By the time they come to us, we see gentamicin eye drops. I don't want to share, the pediatricians, practicing pediatrician would have prescribed, an intern would have prescribed. It's only change. They go to next pediatrician, he recommends topramycin. Third pediatrician, ofloxacillin. By the time they come, you need to patiently tell them that this is a normal phenomenon. Wash your hands, do this. The infant will outgrow. As long as the eyes are clear and inside of the eye is very clean, you need not worry about putting eye drops. And similarly true for umbilical watering. It's a normal phenomenon when the stump falls. There is no role. Keep it dry and clean, that's all. No need to routinely apply any antibiotic cream, powder, or for that matter, any systemic medications.
So if you are using antibiotic eye drops, they're asking which is the drug of choice for eye discharge or eye drops.
If it is purulent eye discharge, there is so much of difficulty opening the eyes, and inside you open and see the whole conjunctiva is looking red. Maybe you are comfortable with ofloxacillin and topramycin. That's what I see our ophthalmic colleagues recommending for neonatal ophthalmia.
Okay, sir. And there is one more question, sir. From your experience, what is your advice on keeping the baby in early morning sunlight for jaundice? So,
if you look at the innovation, innovation of phototherapy, that's how a staff nurse noted that the infants kept next to window in a postnatal ward had less often jaundice as against infants which were kept in the darker side or sun covered area. That's the way the phototherapy has evolved. But doesn't we should not extrapolate that understanding that you encourage mothers. The whole purpose of keeping the infants is warm and clean. You ask them to keep it open and hold it in the sun in the morning, especially in the winter months, maybe it may be tragic. The baby may experience cold, stress and hypothermia. And remember, for the light to act, it takes minimum 20 to 30 minutes. Just holding the sun for 10 to 20 minutes, no doubt, we strongly believe our traditional practices, exposing to sun is good. Maybe ideal in older children and adults. You should be very careful when you want to really practice once it comes to newborn. We don't usually recommend this in our clinical practice.
There is one more question, sir, which we routinely see in our OPD practice. A female baby with vaginal white discharge. So how to go about and when to intervene and when to interpret that as an abnormal vaginal discharge?
I said in my presentation, acne neonatorum, benign breast engorgement, pseudomenses, and white discharge per vagina. These are all hormonal effects.
How long? If it persists?
This can go up to 1 week or even up to second week of life. As long as the infant is feeding well and the general condition is good and you try to separate the labia with clean hands and see rest of the genitalia is normal. Superficial external genitalia infections are uncommon in the newborn. There can't be vaginitis. There can't be any other infection in the female baby for that matter causing vaginal discharge. There is no role for treating in line with any vaginal candidiasis with a suppository or a systemic antifungal. Treat it as a simple physiological variant. No need to treat this with medication. I don't remember treating. This is what I'm telling. What I have shared last 1 hour, I appeal to all my friends who are you have heard to me. Don't depend on ophthalmologist. Don't depend on dermatologist. Don't depend on orthopedic surgeon. Don't depend on pediatric surgeon. We are all in one. Majority of the findings in most of our babies are normal variants. Only thing you need to be knowledgeable. If you are in doubt, you look for it the next day. You see in the first postnatal ward, she raises issue of PD. Second day when you go, mother says this discharge is there. Third day she says today baby is bleeding as well. She gets worried. It's a baby girl. You say this is likely to disappear. That's what I say. If there is pseudomenses and baby has missed vitamin K, it is born elsewhere, ensure that baby receives vitamin K. A healthy newborn should be receiving one intradermal injection, BCG, one subcutaneous or intramuscular injection, vitamin K, at the time of birth, nothing other than that.
Sir, they asked, what is your take on, hello?
I am audio.
Yeah, what's your take on the talc powders, which is used in babies? Should we use,
No need. What we are learning with this corona crisis, let us practice what our parents, our ancestors have practiced. Too much of hygiene, too much of affluence has led to problems. That's what I said. If you put powder, there will be excoriation in the groin. There will be umbilical granuloma. There will be excoriation in the or intertrigo in the neck, in the axilla. All these are iatrogenic problems. All that you need to keep is, we do recommend a gentler baby soap. Don't use adult soap to give bath to the infant. Traditional coconut oil is good enough. Of late, I am very unfortunate. We see these infants, the parents anxiously bringing with a skin oil, shampoo, baby talcum, baby powder, all that. Please discourage all this. All healthy infants should be going home only with vitamin D drops and full of knowledge to the parents how to give breastfeeding and protect their children with vaccine preventable diseases.
So they've asked a few practical doubts again. When to advise parents to give bath in term baby and even in preterm baby? After discharge.
Bathing in hospital setup is deferred. I know most of you are working in very good hospitals, corporate hospitals, wherein you have got a state of art facilities, people who are trained, I can understand. If you are working in a government setup or a district hospital or a crowded hospital, discourage bathing during hospital stay. If the mother happens to stay for a longer period, ask them to use warm water and clean the baby with a clean cloth. Don't bother about that. If you don't do that also, nothing will happen. Otherwise, they will catch superficial skin infection and other iatrogenic infections during hospital stay. So discourage bathing, especially in an Indian scenario. I know in the developed countries, this is a routine practice, but we are talking about parents, patients who are born, who are killed in very crowded hospitals, where in each ward has 40 to 50 babies. Otherwise, you ideally advise giving bath after going home in term babies. There is no contraindication to give bath. Gentle oil application and massaging is recommended, but don't overdo it. You remember people used to practice putting oil into the nose, oral cavity, and these infants developed aspiration pneumonia, lipod pneumonias. Chennai friends have shared this experience in international journals. So you should not overdo anything in clinical practice. If at all you are using, you need to use a baby soap. Not here to promote any particular brand. People have come out with very fancy brands, very expensive soaps. And people ask, can you use some house-made powders, all that? Absolutely fine. I recommend if they are very poor, just cleaning the baby with clean water, warm water is good enough. Keep the skin clean and hygienic. That's all.
Sir, they've asked one more question about the how is pendulous scrotum suggestive of euthermia of a baby?
If baby is experiencing, that holds good for any age group, not necessarily for newborn. If the baby is experiencing, if all adult males can try this as an adult, not necessarily in the newborn. When you are taking a cold shower bath, you see a retraction of the testes. It's an experience. So the scrotal sac gets into the inguinal region. Only when you are euthermic, then only the scrotum is pendulous. And the testicles will be sagging in the scrotal sac. This is a normal phenomenon, not necessarily in the newborn, not all age group. So newborn is no exception. So if you see retractile testes, the scrotal sac is contracted, then you should be worried whether the baby is experiencing a cold stress. We record the temperature of the infant, definitely the temperature will be on the lower side.
Sir, and I will just hold on for a minute again. I request all the participants, if you have any practical doubts, please put your doubts in the chat. So we will take one by one. Sir, what is your take-home message for a practicing pediatricians who only care once the delivery is done or once they are out of NICU, when they first see them, how long they need to spend time for newborn examination?
That's and what I said. Complete.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Yes, sir. And what are the tips and tricks you would want to quickly wrap up? Give suggestions to the practicing OPD pediatrician.
At the beginning of my presentation, I told somebody else would have attended resuscitation, or you yourself have attended resuscitation. Don't plan a detailed neurological examination in the delivery room and try to finish it out. You ensure skin-to-skin contact and initiate breastfeeding in the delivery room. Let them shift the baby to postnatal ward. I have made it very clear. Whatever I discuss, this examination should be planned electively the next day or prior to discharge in the postnatal ward or single room or wherever the mother and infant is. And then on average, it should not take more than 5 to 7 minutes for experienced practicing pediatricians. For a beginner, it may take another couple of minutes extra. Please make it a point that the baby is unclothed, the windows are closed, air conditioning switched off, fan is kept to minimum. And I said in the beginning, good visual inspection of the infant gives. If the baby is crying, if the baby is moving actively, if the baby is spanking, the abdomen is looking fine, the quality of the cry is good, 99% the baby is fine. Only thing you need to do, all cranial nerves are normal, cardiorespiratory system is normal, and external genitalia is visible like that. Not to miss whatever findings I listed, you have to do palpation, auscultation, and those things. So try to get as much information as possible by good inspection. And then you limit your, you don't go methodically, cardiovascular system inspection, palpation, from head to foot end. Try to feel, look at the head, any swelling, gently feel it. Try to make the baby open its mouth. Look for a palate or an extended pearl. Look at the eyes of the baby inside, whether the baby has got subconjunctival hemorrhage or any white reflex. As I said, don't miss retinoblastoma prior to discharge. That is very grave. And look for any swelling in the neck. then accessory nipple, water, chest and abdomen, the umbilical stump, axilla, just turn the baby, have a look at the back of the baby, lift the buttocks and see that the anal orifice is fine, look at the extremities, try to auscultate the heart, try to appreciate for the second heart sound, don't worry too much for the nature of the heart, respiratory sounds, nature of the adventitious sounds all. Please tell honestly, how much stethoscopes come to help in your clinical practice in the newborn? It's inspection and gentler palpation. Most of the time you are correct. You have to do auscultation because parents don't feel comfortable. But if at all you have to auscultate, you have to appreciate the physiological split of the second sound. I made it very clear. You try to feel one upper limb pulse and one lower limb pulse. Try to auscultate for second sound split. And then gently you feel the abdomen, finger palpation. You need not keep the whole hand. Two finger palpation. You can feel the tip of the liver about 2.5 centimeters palpable. Tip of the spleen palpable. You can take your hand and try to feel the kidneys. Keep the hand below and the thumb above and try to feel for the upper limb. Palpable upper pole of the kidney is a normal phenomenon. One kidney. If there is any significantly palpable lump, then you try to go through antenatal scan reports. If it is not done, order for an ultrasound abdomen. For all, it may be a case of renal tumor or hydronephrosis for that matter. Then you try to keep the developmental dysplasia. It causes pain. To appreciate for the developmental dysplasia, you don't complete your examination without looking for it. Take out the nappy. Never look for a developmental dysplasia with a nappy. Let the baby be quiet, awake, and stretch the leg of the baby. And do this in front of the parents. Tell them, the infant may cry when I'm writing, eliciting it. It is not really causing any harm. It may be a little painful when I'm doing it. I'm here, don't worry. And try to do that Barlow's and Ottolani's maneuver, provocative test and the other one. Only, and it should not be done immediately after birth. There are the effects of the hormones and the ligaments around the joints. Physiological clunks are appreciated if it is done within 24 hours. So we have to wait for 48 to 72 hours before you really appreciate developmental dysplasia of the hip. Only if it is in doubt, then only you order for developmental dysplasia hip screening. You need a competent sonologist to look for it. You may do cranial ultrasound. I think it needs expertise. People, it is not all that difficult. And don't order for the X-ray of the hip joint. And at the end, after doing all this, it is very important. Term, 39-weeker, 2.8 kgs, appropriate gestational age baby with erythematoxicum, with physiological jaundice. This is your diagnosis. Feel proud to write this diagnosis in the discharge slip of the infant. Don't all the, aren't you worried about making diagnosis of respiratory distress, meconium aspiration syndrome, asphyxia? We are sick of making this diagnosis. And these diagnoses should be more often written in the discharge slip of the mother and the newborn, rather than just writing birth weight and other things. So before you really label, I said, before you label that the baby is normal, normal healthy newborn, you need to do a meticulous examination. Never do this. If you miss white reflex and retinoblastoma and developmental dysplasia of the hip, I shared with our friends in European countries and United States, you have to know they will cancel your certification. As simple as that. Eye examination and hip examination were very carefully done and should not be missed and documented at the time of discharge. That should be the take-home message from my side, Prashant.
Sir, there is one more question, sir. What should be the ideal follow-up timings to call after the baby is discharged from the hospital? For a term baby.
Yeah, if it is a term baby, there is no reason for them to come back. You are discharged on 4th day, 5th day. What has baby received? Baby has, mother is confident about breastfeeding. Baby is successfully breastfeeding. Baby has passed urine, meconium and transitional stools. The baby has stayed for 5 to 7 days by then. And everything has taken care. Baby has received BCG prior to discharge. And we are very proud that BCG protect from corona. What else you want? Please strongly let us practice BCG for our infants. It should be ongoing practice with us. Then vitamin K is doubly ensured. I think now we don't see any baby without vitamin K, even in the community level. Everybody is giving vitamin K. So polio drops, vitamin K and BCG prior to discharge. And brief them if you are worried that this baby is low birth weight, anything, that is between 1.75 to 2.5 at least. Some babies need help. Such babies, you can call them for after 2 weeks. Otherwise, any babies who are born with normal birth weight, more than 2.5 kg, you can always call them for immunization at 6 weeks of age.
So what about the jaundice if they develop later, after 2 or 3 days of discharge?
If you have discharged baby on fourth day, fourth day after 72 hours, if you have discharged the baby, and at that point of time, you have ensured there is no setting for ABO hemolytic disease, no setting for RH hemolytic disease, and clinically there is no jaundice or very little jaundice on the face. Please instruct parents. You remember, when you are examining, parents will be carefully looking at you. Our doctor didn't look at the eyes to appreciate jaundice. You say, your baby has jaundice. They feel offended. Doctor didn't look at the eye and he said his jaundice. He never looked at the eye. You make it very clear. We look for skin jaundice. Babies have physiological photophobia. I don't wish to look for jaundice in the eyes. It will be as well there. So if there is no jaundice on fourth day, fifth day, at the time of discharge, there is no reason to call them till 6 weeks. If you demonstrate that there is jaundice on face, chest, or abdomen, or as I said, it is a low birth weight infant, you can be quite sure that baby will not have any significant pathological jaundice. If it happens that baby gets discharged because of the rush in the hospital, second day, third day, our hospital, district hospitals, mothers are discharged on second day. Setting is their O&A. We tell them. Unfortunately, innocent ones, as somebody shared that question, you have seen these babies coming back with bind, with bilirubin 30, 34. That should not happen. If you discharge them ideally on fourth or fifth day, there are no issues. If you are discharging them on second day because of stress of work place, then you, I understand, you tell them about these danger signs, jaundice within 24 or 72 hours for that matter, poor feeding, abdominal distension, danger signs. If there are any of these things, then only you come. Otherwise, it is not fair to ask them to come. Otherwise, if they are normal birth weight, normal birth events, normal delivery, confident mother, and you are confident at the time of discharge that everything has gone fine.
So how early we should do red reflex and OAE?
No, the thing is, one examination prior to discharge. It should not be done in the delivery room. Prior to discharge. What is red reflex? Yeah, you need to hold the baby rocking and put a light ray and see that you see the glow from the normal eye. If there is red glow, it is normal. Instead of red reflex, if you see white reflex, that may happen, for example, in advanced ROP when you do for ROP screening in infants, or retinoblastoma. Because it is said white reflex is the earliest clue that the baby may be having retinoblastoma. Document that you have tried and done. I said, opening the eyes of the newborn is very difficult. You need not put lid retractor and do eye examination. Ensure that the infant is comfortable. You do it in front of the parents, hold the infant and try to rock the baby through an angle of 30 to 45, for that matter, 60 degrees. It is a pleasure watching the baby opening the eyes. See that the infant is comfortable. Try to bring the light source from the side. You'll be able to record it and see that there is a red reflex.
Can you unmute Kishore Kumar sir, Dinakar sir, and Kotreshi sir? Meanwhile, there was other few doubts. They have messaged me in Facebook Messenger. What is your take on hiccups, sneezing, and sometimes baby cough? Because this is the common complaints what parents come with on a follow-up visit. When to consider that as normal, whether it is normal or what should be done or what should not be done?
Yes. Sneezing of the infant once in a while is a normal phenomenon. And throwing milk is also a very normal phenomenon.
Prashant, video on madu.
As long as the infant is feeding well, gaining weight, you should make it very clear. There's a nice proverb in Kannada. So some mothers will be secreting and lactating wonderful amount of milk. These infants
are
very smart. They swallow milk, I keep telling. Esophagus food milk, not stomach food. In the sleep state, if they swallow milk too much and it causes the gastroesophageal junction, it refluxes into esophagus and the baby may throw out the milk. Unless you are making a diagnosis of GERD, as in premature babies, all that, There is no role for routine prokinetic agents or like domperidone or ondansetron or other. My take home message today is very clear. Avoid medications in your day to day healthy clinic, well baby clinic.
Sir Dinakar sir.
Yeah, good evening.
Kishore Kumar sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Kishore Kumar sir. Sir Kishore Kumar sir. Kotreshi sir. Bidri sir.
Kotreshi sir.
Just unmute Sujay. Unmute Dr. Kishore Kumar sir. Kotreshi sir. And Dr. Bidri. Lakshman Bidri sir.
Sir Guruprasad sir. Sir, today very good, sir. Very good response. Actually, Facebook itself more than 300 plus people are there. YouTube more than 444 at 6 o'clock. So here also it is crossed more than 470. Sir, you are a great teacher. All over India, all over India, everybody is logged in. Just one only we have sent. Everybody logged in. Good response, sir. Totally, we have crossed around 1,000 people watched your talk.
Thank you, thank you. Thank you very much for you made this lockdown pleasurable. I just blessed that the e-seminars, e-classes are going to be very useful for the audience henceforth. Because another 2 weeks concrete time you have, I just request Prashant and Dinakar, you can plan after 3 clinical topics, maybe sometime by somebody, gestational age assessment. You take for granted that you know how to assess gestational age. And similarly, neurological examination of the newborn.
Sir, one more question, sir. How to diagnose or how to handle colic and whether use of certain colic digestive enzymes, is it helpful? What is your experience and your message to all the youngsters, sir?
All term babies should be going home with very clearly training for breastfeeding, maternal infant bonding, and a word about danger signs that they have to look for and report if there are any of them, and no other medications. Very often parents ask, please prescribe something for fever, something for cold, something if the baby cries.
Something for gas also, sir. Commonly they ask.
Something for nose. Mm-hmm. Usually we discourage. We say no such things happens. And do you remember our ancestors used to practice putting breast milk to the eyes?
Eyes and nose.
Scientific evidence of that. And mother's milk or the colostrum has probably with the best anti-infective properties compared to any available antibiotic drops or ear drops in the market. But that doesn't mean you should encourage that. So don't touch any of these things. And as I said, putting up the milk is very common. And as long as the baby is feeding, gaining weight, there is no reason to consider anti-reflux medications in term babies.
Kutresh sir, please talk.
Number two, there is no role for any anti-colic medications. Colic is uncommon. The classic description itself is infantile colic or 3 months colic. It is uncommon in the first month of life. I understand of late low birth weight infants may be breast bottle fed or spoon fed or palada fed. They may swallow a lot of air. That risk is always there. But you should ensure that the feeding techniques are correct. Baby is bloated, has brought out the air. Reasonable burping is done. Discourage using anticholic medications. So I think even FDA don't recommend use of anticholic medications for the management of FDA. These are all transient phenomena. Make parents very clear. Your baby is crying only at a particular time of the day. Other time, baby is absolutely fine feeding well. So you need not worry. I think she will get convinced. Yes, Prashant. I think I made the point.
Yes. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sir, Dinakar, sir. Hello. Hello, Dinakar, sir.
I think he got lost.
Yeah. Kotreshi, sir, are you there?
Sujay, can you unmute Kotreshi sir and Kishore Kumar sir? Dinakar sir? We'll get full screen. Okay. I think these are the questions, sir, which have come as of now. I think we lost Dinakar, sir. Sujay? Is Sujay around, sir?
Yes, Anil is with me, yeah.
Aman?
Anil,
yeah. Yeah. Okay, can you unmute Dinakar, sir, Kotreshi, sir, and Kishore Kumar, sir, and Bidri, sir? Aman?
Yes, sir. Tell me, sir. Hello?
Can you unmute all these three people? Hello, can you unmute Dr. Kishore Kumar, sir, Dr. Dinakar,
Dinakar, sir? Not here. Dr. Dinakar is already unmuted. And Dr.
Kotreshu.
I think we had a really long session. I think, Prashant, you can close it.
Yeah. Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir.
Hello.
And Kishore, sir, has specifically sent a message, sir.
Yeah.
Kishore, sir, has sent a specific message. Thanking you for you being such a wonderful teacher for so many long years, and you have taught so many students. Your students are there all across the globe, across the country, who are trying their level best to keep up your name. So you specifically mentioned as a great teacher, and Dr. Pradeep GCM also has mentioned. Thank you for the wonderful presentation. Dr. Dinakar sir already told you, sir. Kotreshi sir has messaged. And even Lakshman Bidri sir also has messaged, but unfortunately we could not able to hear from them. Thank you very much, sir. We will close the session.
From my side, we would like to Prashant, immensely again, I thank
you, sir.
Dinakar, Dr. Kishore, Dr. Bidri, Dr. Kotureesh. I think we should be prepared for this type of teaching and learning for next few months, as it is analyzed. We have to practice social distancing. And earlier conferences won't happen in the near future, and you can't keep away from learning. I appreciate your efforts. Plan a very meticulous schedule, and my only request is every fourth or fifth topic, you can keep something like this, a clinical topic of relevance for practicing pediatrician, residents and fellows who are learning in different units. I thank all the participants who have attended this meeting and made us very happy with very close interaction. Thank you, Ananda.
Thank you, sir. Doctor, sir, Prasanth, sir, can I stop this meeting?